not intentionally. Ow. I'm all dirty now.
Hey guys, and welcome back to another episode of Tech Tuesday, where we talk about tech on a Tuesday. I thought that would be smoother than it was. It wasn't, but you know, live and you learn. Today's episode is all about anatomical girths and how they were used as a secret weapon in the 2012 Olympic Games. I don't know if this happens to anybody else out there, but it happens to me with an alarming level of frequency where I will have a very, well, not very dumb, but like a questionably dumb thought. And I'm left really grateful that no one in the vicinity could read my mind. For instance, this last week, I was going through my tack room and cleaning my tack and like organizing it all, making sure none of it was getting moldy. Turns out I was a little bit behind the curve on that one. Some of my stuff had a brief frosting and mold, but I've taken care of that now and it's no more. But I came across my stump girth, and in my head, I was like, oh, I didn't know I had an anatomical girth. I don't have an anatomical girth. That's the issue. For some reason, I was equating the wider belly piece of a stud girth to that meaning it was anatomical. I was getting confused, like anatomical girth designs and a stud girth for some reason. Like there's stud girths out there that are designed to be anatomical, but I, for some reason, was thinking like the whole entirety of stud girths all were anatomical, and they're not. Like stud girths are specifically designed to protect horses while they're jumping from clipping their stomach with their shoes or their studs. They're not designed to disperse pressure any differently than a standard girth or to be performing better than a standard girth, other than to be providing more protection. But for some reason, like, I have a bad habit of just like confusing two different products. But I guess like it was kind of a blessing in disguise because it let me down this whole rabbit hole, shall we say, of anatomical girths and learning about the information out there on them, as well as, once again, the sheer lack of information out there. But I started thinking about anatomical girths and trying to figure out, you know, is the designs behind anatomical girths actually doing something different than that of standard girths? Are they doing what they claim? And, you know, I thought about the total saddle fit girths. You know, they have such a large following of people that give them a positive response, and so many people have said they use total saddle fit girths and have seen a huge difference in their horses. And I wonder, you know, why is that? What is there out there that can either back that up or explain to me why so many people are seeing such positive results with these style of girths? Which, I guess, brings us to the whole research part of anatomical girths. And as it turns out, surprise, surprise, there's like nothing out there. Shockingly though, there's actually a lot of research out there about girths in general. One of the largest research areas is standard girths and how they interact or like the relationship with the horse's respiratory system, which is an important topic all on its own, don't get me wrong. It just wasn't quite the information I was looking for and it just wasn't quite the information I was looking for in relation to anatomical girths. Also, even weirder down the whole rabbit hole of how our girths impact our horse's breathing is out of like a dozen different studies, they have conflicting answers on that. It actually turns out in more recent studies that there's not a relationship between the tightness of your girth and impacting how your horse breathes or the function of your horse's respiratory system. What they did find a correlation between and like a relationship between was the tightness of the girth affecting the horse's thoracic dimensions. And the thorax is the cavity that holds the horse's lungs and like other organs. So there is a relationship between tighter girths affecting the thorax's dimensions. However, there is not a relationship between your girth affecting how your horse breathes, which doesn't give you free rein to like crank down your girth and tighten it as tight as you possibly can. It just means in those specific studies where they're looking for a relationship in that one area, it didn't pan out. But there's still other impacts and like physiological effects of over-tightening your girth, if that makes sense. Before I dismiss the studies though that were talking about the relationship between standard girths and the horse's respiratory system, I did read through a bunch and I actually found one that was done in 2006 that looked at the relationship between the horse's thoracic dimensions and the equine locomotion, which is just a fancy way of saying how a horse moves. They noted that there was a relationship between increased girth tension and that there was a reduced time. Oh gosh, some of their sentences are very confusing to read. But essentially what they found was that there was a relationship between increased girth tension and horses tiring out quicker or becoming fatigued quicker. And originally, in a study done back in 1999, this was attributed to tightness of girth restricting the horse's breathing. So they thought that the horses got tired quicker because the tighter girth was affecting the horse's respiratory function, but has actually been amended since, and it's noted that the tighter the girths were, they were actually interfering with the horse's motion. So the reason the horses were becoming tired quicker wasn't because it was impacting their breathing, it's because the tighter girth wasn't allowing their muscles to work as they should and work as efficiently as they could. So with how some of the horses' muscles work is they have to expand and contract, and with the tighter girth, the muscles couldn't contract and become shorter and thicker because of the tightness of the girth, meaning that the horse's range of motion was limited, or at least like the range of their muscles was limited. So essentially, the horses with tighter girths suffered muscle fatigue sooner than those with looser girths. And where this all ties into anatomical girths is that with the Fairfax Performance Girth or the Total Saddle Fit Shoulder Relief option, they operate under this idea of relieving peak pressure spots that are caused by standard girths. And these peak pressure spots are what are interfering with the horse's motion. So these peak pressure spots are what are restricting the movement of the horse's musculature and not allowing that muscle to expand or contract its full motion, what it needs to be able to do for the horse to be operating at peak efficiency, I guess. It wasn't actually until I was down a completely different rabbit hole that looked at myofascial lines in the horse's body that I read a study done in Australia that investigated the myofascial trigger points in the horse's pectoral muscles and how that linked to girth aversion behavior. And I think I've previously talked about myofascial lines in my anatomical vital video, but just like a brief recap, myofascial lines run throughout the horse's entire body and have shown that what happens in one part of the horse's body is not an isolated incident, is that like what's happening in their head affects the entire horse's body all the way down into their hooves. So for instance, a standard bridle that can put pressure on the horse's myofascial lines in their face can affect their hind end movement as well as like the flexion in their hocks. Like it shows how important these myofascial lines and trigger points are with how any of our tack interacts with our horse's body. And what they found in the study done in Australia was that standard girths put pressure on the myofascial trigger points behind the horse's elbow. And it was there that I found reference to the one and only study out there that actually looks at an anatomical girth and compares it to a standard girth. And guess who did this study? Drumroll please. Fairfax Saddles! I honestly think they're becoming like one of my favorite brands just because their name keeps popping up in all these different like avenues of research that I'm actually like, they're answering questions that I'm asking. So it's super cool to see their different research, and also they're putting like a lot of research and money into the designs behind their own equipment and gear, which is really cool. Like it's super cool to see a company that's willing to do that. I also really like their research because while it is done for them and for their benefit on looking into how their products work and how their products are affecting horses' bodies, the information and the results they find in these studies can totally be applied to like a bunch of different brands tech out there. So the information that they find out on their girth is totally applicable to another anatomical girth, like Total Saddle Fit. I also appreciate that their studies are published publicly and are free to read, so I don't have to pay them. They like just pop up in a nice pretty PDF that allows me to look through the entire study instead of just like leaving me at the abstract when you can't read anything else without paying, which sucks. But anyways, they did a study back in July 2013 called, prepare yourselves, they like put a beefy title, and I don't know why they made their title so long, but they made it really long. Girth pressure measurements reveal high peak pressures that can be avoided using an alternative girth design that also results in increased limb contraction and flexion in the swing phase. Essentially, they were comparing a standard girth to an anatomical girth and seeing how that affected the horse's motion, movement, as well as like the pressure beneath each girth. And so they had two goals in this study. Their first goal was to determine locations of peak pressure points under a range of different girths. And their second goal was to compare the horse's gait with a standard girth and a girth designed to avoid peak pressure points. In the first part of their study, they used 10 different horses where they used a pressure mat underneath the standard girth to determine points of peak pressure. And they measured pressure beneath 15 girths, 9 of which were standard and 6 of which were dressage girths. In the second part of the study, they used 20 different horses. They had 9 dressage horses, 9 eventers, and 2 jumpers. And actually, really interestingly enough, all the horses included in that 20 were part of the British Equestrian Federation World Class Program. And this was the part of the study where they were comparing a standard girth and a girth intentionally designed to avoid causing peak pressure points. And the way they were measuring this was they put a pressure mat underneath the girth, as well as they also took high-speed video of the hind limb and forelimb retraction, which is just the action of extending like the horse's full range of motion of their legs. They also used the high-speed video to capture the flexion in the horse's knees and hocks. And what they found was that standard girths had a peak pressure point in the musculature behind the elbow of the horse. The pressure mat actually revealed that the forces of the standard girth were 22% on the left and 14% on the right, greater than that of their anatomically designed girth. And peak pressure of the standard girth was 76% on the left and 98% on the right, greater than that of their anatomically designed girth. Those numbers are pretty high for the amount of, like, I don't know to anybody else, but to me, those numbers are a lot more significant and drastic than what we've seen in previous study. I mean, a 98% difference in the pressure exerted between the standard girth and the anatomically designed girth is pretty big. As far as like limb retraction goes, when the horses wore their girth, which was girth F, the anatomically designed girth, there was a 6 to 11% greater forelimb protraction and 10 to 20% greater hindlimb protraction. They did only see a marginal increase in flexion between 3 to 4%, but it is still a little bit more than what the standard girth offered. It's also suggested that after looking at the research on the myofascial lines throughout the horse's body and how girths were affecting the myofascial lines in the body, that part of the success of the Fairfax pressure relief girth could be due to its avoidance of these myofascial trigger points that previous studies looked at, which is really cool and totally makes sense. Also, like, it just means that all this research is compounding on itself, and I don't know, it's so interesting how it all builds off of one another. And what I found super interesting was, like, you know how I mentioned that the 20 horses used in the second part of the study were all a part of the British Equestrian Federation team officials for Team Great Britain in the Olympics and stuff were involved or like overseeing part of the study and got to see the results of this study. And they actually were so impressed by the girth and their results that they asked Fairfax to keep it a secret and delay its launch until after the London Olympics because they thought it would give Team Great Britain an added advantage. Which, based off the results they saw in the study, is totally true. Like, that's so freaking cool and wild and weird and, like, I don't know. I wish I saw USEA's name on different studies out there putting their money and, like, efforts towards tack to improve the horse's, like, performance. Like, that's so cool. And Fairfax is a brand based out of the UK, so it's so cool that they are using, you know, a local brand. They got to find information and do research and studies on it, and then they use that to their advantage in the Olympics. That's freaking awesome. But where does that leave us with anatomical girths versus standard girths? And I think even though there's limited research and studies directly comparing the standard girth to anatomical one, if you combine the research done by Fairfax Saddles in conjunction with research done on the myofascial trigger points, as well as how standard girths are impacting the thoracic dimensions on the horse's body, I would argue there's enough science in favor of anatomical girths, and there's enough research that is showing that anatomical girths can make a huge difference to our horses. I do have a caveat though to that one, is that I'm kind of on the fence with a lot of brands though, is that there's limited research on who's looking at how their girth affects horses. And I'm kind of wager that probably half the anatomical girths being sold out there are just mimicking other brands that they see. They're just mimicking other designs and might not actually be avoiding pressure points or reducing pressure exerted by the girth. They might have the cutouts for the elbow in the wrong portion, so they might be only halfway relieving the pressure off that pressure point. Or if you're not measuring the anatomical girth correctly to fit that horse, it's not going to have the maximum desired benefits as if a girth was appropriately fitted to that horse, if that makes sense. And some girths don't have enough sizing options. So it makes me skeptical of a lot of brands out there. But I would say for brands such as like Total Saddle Fit, Fairfax Performance Girth, the Lemieux Gel Tech, and like a handful of other brands out there have designs to avoid these sensitive areas and avoid impacting the horse's sensitive musculature right behind their elbow. And they're probably going to be more comfortable for your horse than a traditional girth. I do know that there's those one girths created by Steuben, and there's like a bunch of different designs of girths out there. I don't really have any information one way or the other on those ones because they don't necessarily have the same design, and I'm guessing same pressure dispersal as a standard girth, but they also don't have the same design as the shoulder relief or like elbow cutout girths do. So I don't know where they fall in that range. Are they better than a standard girth? Worse than an anatomical one? Are they the best anatomical one out there? I don't really know as far as like that Steuben one design goes. You know, I wish they had more information on theirs, but I couldn't find anything. The only actual issue I have with the anatomical girths, specifically Fairfax, is that they're ridiculously expensive. I mean, maybe not ridiculously. The brand's gotta make money. I understand that. But they're like $300. I'm just a normal wee peasant out here. I can't afford that. Like, I would love to put one of these girths on my horse. I would love to try one out. But I can't afford one at $300. That's insane. That's a lot. So a more affordable option than the Fairfax Performance Girth would also be the Total Saddle Fit Shoulder Relief Girth. Although, I did run into a dead end with Total Saddle Fit, trying to research them, where I'm kind of confused. I think Total Saddle Fit totally has the benefits that I was just stating and all these research and studies that we're finding. It was just interesting how Total Saddle Fit came about to where Justin Baghi? Oh, I'm so sorry, I butchered your name. The brand Total Saddle Fit was established in 2012 because the professional saddle fitter Justin kept running into the issue of saddles sliding forward onto the horse's shoulder. And his idea was to create a girth that straightened out the billets and prevented the saddle from sliding forward. And they did that. I think also, though, in that design of straightening out the billets, is they also avoided that sensitive tissue around the elbow and they avoided that sensitive musculature, creating a pretty beneficial design, if that makes sense. So overall, it looks like anatomical girths are actually really good, and they have quite a lot of benefits. Team officials were so impressed they had Fairfax saddles keep it under wraps to use as their secret weapon in the Olympics. Anyways, thank you guys so much for sticking with me through today's Tap Tuesday episode. I know it was kind of more of a boring and dry one, but hopefully it wasn't. I don't know. Also, next week's will be a lot more interesting. If you find yourself and you're interested in more information about different pieces of tack out there, different brands, different products, you can go listen to my podcast. It's called In the Barn. It's available all over the place. If you have any questions, comments, concerns, topics you want me to discuss, leave a comment down below in the comments. Make sure you subscribe, and I will see you guys next time. Bye! I don't know why I said that.